All right, so guys, thanks so much for coming out. This is the best angle I could kind of find. So if you guys want to come around behind me, if you want to see, that's not going to bother me at all. I'm trying something new this time. I'm actually recording. We have one of our regulars that loves these clinics who is not able to attend tonight. So I thought I would record it for him. So everybody say, hey, Crawford, how are you?
Hey,
all right, so if this sticks, maybe we'll, yeah. If this sticks, maybe we'll do some more of this stuff and I'll record them and I'll start posting them on YouTube where you guys can see them, right? And that way, if you can't make it or you want some review, we'll do that. So I'm all mic'd up. I don't know if it's going to work or not, but we're going to give it a shot. So this week's topic is pitching. And for those of you who have attended in the past, you're going to know that we have been on kind of a short game run here, right? We started with green reading. And then we talked about some bunkers. Last month was chipping, and now we're moving it out a little bit to pitching. Now, I'm going to give you a new term for pitching, right? I put pitching in the email, and I say pitching because that's a familiar term. I'm going to call it something different, okay? I'm going to call it mini wedge play, okay? So this is a mini wedge. Now, that's not any different than chipping. I just use a different terminology, and I want to go ahead and get that out front. So if you hear me say mini wedge, you don't get confused, okay? I classify this shot roughly 15 to 20 yards away from the green and back to about 50 yards, okay? Now, earlier last month, we talked about the shot I called chipping and kind of hinge and hold. I mentioned that a little bit. I'll talk a little bit more about that tonight. But chipping is kind of from about, you know, the edge of the green to about 5 yards back. We classify as a chip. What I call a hinge and hold is from about 5 yards away to about 15 to 20 yards away. And then pitching or mini wedge play picks up at about 15 to 20 and goes back to about 40 to 50. Now, the reason those are ranges is because it, you know, it depends on the person and the speed at which they play, right? And you're gonna understand what I mean by that in a minute, but this is kind of an important zone here, right? Most of your research on statistics in golf will tell you that the average distance you will have to hit a wedge in a normal round of golf is about 15 yards, okay? So this is kind of the beginning of where it gets really important, because the research shows you're going to spend more time in this area than you will anywhere else. And it's a pretty important part of most people's game, because if you can get this thing on the green somewhere in the vicinity of the hole, I don't even mean close to the hole, then you can make a bogey, right? And to most people, not everybody, some people have higher standards than that, but to most folks, if you're 25 to 50 yards away from a hole and you can get out of there in three, you've accomplished something, right? And that's what this is about, is trying to teach you how to hit a shot that's just going to get it on the green, not going to be sailing over it or sculled and short in this bunker, right? It's going to land somewhere on the green, hopefully roll somewhere in the vicinity of the hole and give you a chance to make a putt, right? So if you've been to the last couple of clinics, this will be a little bit of review. If you haven't, this will be new. And I want to just spend a couple of minutes talking technique, right? Something you've seen so far, but you may not have appreciated. We haven't talked a whole lot about lower body movement in the backswing. And there's a reason for that, because in my opinion, there shouldn't be any lower body movement this close to the green, okay? This is really mostly upper body. Now, with that being said, we're going to do some things with our body to set ourselves up for success. And for those of you who've taken some short game instruction from me in the past, you know what I'm talking about. We're going to position our body in a way that allows us the best chance to hit that shot, but we're not going to move our lower body a whole lot, right? So you're not going to see me making a lot of hip turn on the way back or a lot of weight shift on the way back. What I'm doing is going to be mostly shoulders, arms, and wrists, right? And that's the reason this mini wedge play is really in that 15 to 40 yard zone, because much outside 40 yards, I've got to use my hips a little just to make a big enough backswing. And we'll cover that in a subsequent month, right? But for right now, we're close enough to where, in my personal teaching philosophy and opinion, we shouldn't have a whole lot of lower body involved on the backswing. The downswing's a little bit of a different story. We do have some lower body involved in the downswing, but it's quite different than most people think, okay? This is really more of a rotational type motion with the lower body. And what I mean by that is there's not a whole lot of slide toward the target. The knees don't do a whole lot of buckling, right? We're gonna preset in a position, and the only thing I'm gonna ask people to do is just take their belt buckle and rotate it as they strike, okay? From a lower body standpoint, that's really as simple as it's gonna get, or as complicated as it's gonna get, okay? Distance in this game around the green should be judged by length of swing, okay? It gets a little different when we get to short game as opposed to the full swing, because out there the whole idea is we change the golf club, right? And I wanna bring that philosophy to short game as well. Okay, I can hit it high, or I can hit it low, or I can hit it short, or I can hit it long, and never change the way I move simply by using a 60 degree wedge versus a 52 degree wedge. But to some degree, we have to adjust how long we swing it in short game. And that's one of the challenges to this part of the game, because out there, we can kind of get into this rhythm and we can kind of get into this habit where we got all these pieces moving and the timing is all right, and sometimes we get it going. But then all of a sudden we come across a shot where we have to make it, you know, a swing that's, let's call it 30% length. And then the next hole it's 60% length. And then the next hole it's 15% length. And you can appreciate why this game can be difficult inside of about 75 yards, okay? So far, with the chip shot, all we moved was our shoulders, okay? There was no lower body movement on the way back. It was just a shoulder rock and maybe just a little bit of softness in the right arm. Those of you who were there last week, you'll remember, or last month, you'll remember me talking about that. That shot's definitely not the right shot to hit here, because quite frankly, that's just not gonna go far enough, right? Now, if I were really close to the green, that would work great, but I'm not, okay? So I gotta hit it farther. How do I do that? I make a larger golf swing, okay? The next step in the piece that we talked about briefly last month, and I'll review again this month, was what I called the hinge and hold. The hinge and hold simply added some wrist hinge to the shoulder motion that came in chipping, okay? And as I add wrist hinge, the club head travels farther, and as the arc gets longer, it will have more speed, okay? So if I hit the hinge and hold, it looks something like this, okay? Again, a handy shot if I'm, you know, 10 to 12 to 15 yards away from the green, not a good shot here. I need to hit it farther, okay? That's where we get into this mini wedge player into pitching, okay? Now, the piece that we add technique-wise to pitching, so we had shoulders and chipping, we had wrist hinge and shoulders and hinge and hold. We're simply gonna add arm swing to those two pieces, okay? You can call it arm lift if you want, but I call it more of a swing because your shoulders are continuing their turn just as you were in your normal swing. They're just not going so far that your hips have to get involved, okay? For most people, that's about left arm parallel to the ground. Most people don't have the flexibility to go any further than that without involving their hips, okay? And it's okay if you do, that's just a whole nother shot I'm gonna wait till next month to talk about, right? So you're gonna see me go about to parallel with the ground with my arm, and you'll notice my hips don't move when I make that motion, okay? Maybe an inch or two, but I mean, they're pretty quiet, and that's what motion is involved in a pitch shot, okay? But there's one important thing we have to do before we hit that shot, and that's position our body to where we don't have to move, okay? In order to do that, I need to get your sternum, or the center of your body, in front of the golf ball, okay? Let me say that again, your sternum in front of the golf ball. So if I just address this, and I'll do this a few different angles so you guys can see me. If I put the ball in the middle of my stance and I just let this hang down under my chin, where's my chest, Duncan, you're at this angle, where's my chest relative to the golf ball? Okay, so if I want to put my chest in front of it, can I slide my knees and put my weight and get my chest in front of it? I got my weight left, but I didn't get my chest left, right? So I literally wanna move my chest left to get it in front of the ball. Does that make sense? Okay, I'll do that for you guys. So if I'm standing here and my chest is over the ball and I just put weight in my left leg, did that really move my chest? It didn't, right? I got weight left. My weight's left, coach. Yeah, but it's not left the right way because your chest didn't move. So I need your chest to move, okay? Now, it doesn't move much, an inch or two, but that's enough to accomplish what we need, okay? Crawford, I'll do that one more time for you in the camera, right? So I can't just slide my knees, right? I've got to move my chest, and that actually moves the club and gets it forward. Really, really important thing here, okay? If your chest is behind it, you'll never be able to hit this shot consistently because as the chest and the mass of the body are behind the golf ball, we have no choice to throw at it with our hands. That might be familiar to some people that are standing around. If you've heard that said, you've seen that, and when that happens, you either hit behind it and you hit it fat, you hit behind it and the club bounces off the ground, hits in the middle of the golf ball, and you hit it 80 yards, right? Or you hit it thin altogether and it goes 120 yards, right? And yeah. Yes, sir.
As opposed to moving the back of your stance, which would also get your chest.
It would, but it's a great question. I'm getting ready to talk about why that's not always the best option, okay? So did everybody hear his question? Why can't you just move it back in your stance and that'll put your chest forward? Okay, for those of you who attended last month, if you remember what I talked about, when you move your chest forward, what's that do to shaft lean? When you move it back in your stance, what's the shaft, how's the shaft leaning, Daly?
Forward,
and what's that do to loft?
It decreases loft.
Right, and in a shot like this where I need loft, that could be problematic, okay? Now, to some respects, I can just use a higher lofted club and do that, and that will work, right? But that's not always the best option because sometimes it has to go high and soft, okay? It's not much. It's about an inch, right? But you're going to start with the ball right in the middle of your stance. You maybe can put it a ball forward of the center if you choose, okay? And then you're just going to take your chest and just slide it left about an inch. Now, if somebody wasn't paying attention, you probably wouldn't even notice that I'd moved left, right? It's not much, but it's just enough to get my sternum in front. And now my body's set up in a place to where all I have to do is use my shoulders, my wrist, and my arms, and I can strike the golf shot properly. Okay? If you mean balance in the sense of 50-50, no. I'm heavy into the left leg. Probably 60 to 65% of my weight's in my left leg. And it's gonna stay there, right? That's an important thing to remember. Once I set it there and I get my sternum in front, I'm never gonna move my sternum off of it, right? It's gonna stay right there. My head's gonna stay stable, my chest is gonna stay stable, and I'm just gonna work my arms and shoulders. That make sense to everybody? Okay? That's from a setup standpoint, it really is that simple, okay? Now, most people make the big mistake of giving me knee slide. Right? So they like to get in here, right? And they give me one of these, right? So they get working in there and the knees start getting forward and they think they're okay because the weight's left. They can feel weight in their left leg and in their left hip. And they go, well, coach, one of my chest in front of it, I got weight left, right? I'm thinking of you right now, John. That's where you started, right? I mean, when you got up there, you kind of gave me a lot of knee slide, right? I just happened to be coaching John in short game and that was an issue for him. It happens to a lot of people. Sorry, my eyes caught you there and I had to pull you out, right?
I'm guilty.
So we talked a lot about getting up and over on his left leg instead of into his left leg. Those are just the terms I used, right? But that's a big problem for a lot of folks. They feel weight in that left hip and they think they're good. And what's really happening is their weight's sliding forward, but their chest isn't moving. And they're setting themselves up to fail, right? Because you can't deliver the golf club properly if your chest isn't in front. Does that make sense to everybody from a setup standpoint? Now let's talk about what proper delivery means, right? So I've set you up to deliver it properly. Well, what's that mean? I want you to think about an airplane landing on a runway, okay? It doesn't come in steep and nosedive, right? It doesn't come in so flat that it hits the cars on the interstate that it's crossing over before it lands. It comes in at a gentle angle, descending until it hits the ground. And that's exactly how I want you to think about the golf club moving, okay? It's moving down, but it's a shallow angle of down. Does that make sense to everybody? It's not a steep, huge divot angle down. It's a shallow angle down. And the bounce that's built into the golf club, we talked a little bit about that in the bunker session, protects the club from digging into the dirt. And that's why you get this glide right across the sand. I mean, you watched me hit three shots here earlier, and I barely bruised the grass, right? There weren't any big, large divots. And that's because the golf club was coming in at a downward angle, but at a shallow downward angle to where it just skims right across the dirt. Does that make sense to everybody? Everybody always asks me, well, how do you get that wedge shot that spins, right? How do you get that thing to take two hops and stop? And that's the trick to it right there. You gotta have a golf club that's coming down, but not too steep, not up, right? Not hitting behind it and bouncing into it, but gently and shallowly descending. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay? And you can stand here and you can hit wedge shots. Now I'm gonna go to that middle flag, which is about 45 yards away. I've got a 56 degree sand wedge. I'm not saying that's what all of you have to use. It might be 60 for you, it might be 52 for you, it might be pitching wedge for somebody else, right? But this just happens to be the distance for me to be able to make the golf swing with just my arms and my shoulders and strike down descending, right? To where the golf ball hits, takes a couple of hops and stops, right? Gentle and shallow descending blow. You do that by placing your chest and sternum in front and by not using your lower body a whole lot in the backswing. Now, the ball's not gonna go very far. I mean, I couldn't hit it much further than that using this technique, because if I go any more, then my body's gotta get involved. Now, that's a shot I gotta learn to hit from 75 to 80 yards away, but that's a whole nother technique, right? When you get into that distance, it's almost like a mini full swing. This is not a mini full swing. Let me get that out right now. This is different than a full swing, okay? There are pieces that are similar, but this is different. In a full swing, we absolutely have turn. We absolutely have weight shift, right? We've got a lot of forward slide into the shot. It's not a full swing, okay? This is a very different type golf swing, okay? So the chest is forward. The ball is a little forward of center. And I'm just arms. Hit that one a little hard. But it should stop, right? Okay? Now let's talk about some expectations here, okay? And then I'll hit some more shots and I'll talk about some different distances. What would you think the average, What would you think the proximity to the hole from 30 to 50 yards for the average PGA Tour player is? The guy that's sitting at 60th on the money list, making $1.5 million a year playing golf, not counting endorsements, right? How close does he hit it in feet from 30 to 50 yards? Out of the fairway.
5 feet.
6 feet. Okay, so this is typical, right? We're all over the map. I heard as low as 5, and I think I heard as high as 15, maybe. It's about 12 feet, okay? It's right at about 12 feet. All right, that's the average PGA Tour player. Okay, now I don't mean disrespect when I say this, but are any of us standing in this crowd average, including me, average PGA Tour players? No, our skill level's not that high. So should our expectation be 10 feet? Should it be 20 feet? Yeah, probably not. Right? I mean, I'm shooting for on the back half of the green, if that's where the flag is, right? Or I'm shooting for the front half of the green. Now, as you get better, your expectation level, of course, will increase, right? And you'll want to hit it closer. But what I'm trying to get at is the technique won't change. The skill level just has to improve, right? And what I'm trying to do is teach you guys a method here. A method's a strong word, but I'm trying to teach you a way to hit a mini wedge shot or a pitch shot to where you can keep it on the green and get it in the vicinity of the hole. Okay? Does that make sense to you? And it really is that simple, right? I don't want you guys to complicate it any more than that. I want you to set up to it with a ball just a little forward of center. I want you to get your chest in front of it, just about an inch. And I want you to stay really quiet. Weight's gonna stay left. It's just arms, right? And you're gonna hit it just hard enough to get it to fly the distance you need, right? Now let's talk about how to hit it longer and how to hit it shorter, okay? I mentioned before that I've only got my arm swing as far as my shoulders and arms can move without my lower body moving, okay? And I can tell you that's about my maximum with this club. But what if I had to go to that next flag back there?
How many yards is that?
About 45. The first flag is about 35, I'm estimating, right? The back flag, well, I shot the first one with a laser. It's definitely 35 from right here. The next one I'm estimating about 45. The next one I'm going to say is about 50, okay? Can you even see those flags from where you are? Okay, good. All right, so what if I had to go to the back flag? Somebody shout it out. How would you hit it farther? Okay, good, right? A lot of people answer that question by saying I would hit it harder. Right? Harder means that you change your tempo, right? Harder means that you stand here and go faster as you hit it, right? Now there are some people, easy, oh, thank you. There are some people that play golf that way and that's okay. But what I'm getting at is I don't think that's the best way to do it, right? Because now you're having to change the way you move every time the flag gets about three yards closer or further away. You've got to come up with a different speed, right? I would rather just keep that speed and go to a different golf club, right? So your tempo doesn't have to change. And that's the beauty of having 14 clubs on the big golf course, right? I ask people this question all the time. I think I asked it last month, right? If you hit a full pitching wedge 115 yards, right? And you hit that shot on one hole and it goes up there nice and you two putt for your par, and then you come to the next hole and you got 135 yards into the green, you just hit a harder pitching wedge, right? Nobody does that, right? You hit a 9-iron or you hit an 8-iron or you go up a club. That's what the game was designed to do. But yet we come to short game and we go brain dead and we try to hit golf clubs harder, right? I mean, we start trying to do things with our body because we think we need to hit it harder to get it to go farther. And I just think that's a harder way to play golf, because I could go to the next golf club up, which is a 52 degree gap wedge for me, and I could set up and literally make the exact same swing, and because the club is longer, right, the ball will go farther, okay, just like it does out there when you use an 8-iron, 7-9-iron or a pitching wedge. Not because I move different, I move the same. This game's hard enough. Let's figure out how to move one way, right? And then try to change this as much as we can, okay? So what if I needed to go shorter? What if I needed to go to the first flag? Yeah, I just use a 60 degree, right? So I'm gonna set up to it and I'm gonna hit the exact same shot. Chest is forward, ball's a little forward, just my arms and shoulders. Oh, chunk that one a little. See, we all make bad mistakes sometimes. Let's try that again. Right, ball's gonna go shorter. Ooh, still a little short, right? We'll try that one more time. Because I have a higher lofted golf club, the same amount of effort makes the ball come out higher and therefore shorter. There we go. What's, say, what is? Why do you think that's the case? I mean, why?
I don't know. I'm afraid of it for some reason. I can chunk it like that easier than I can if it's a differently lofted club.
It may be because it has your 60 degree has less bounce and it has less protection on the bottom of the club. I would tell you that they're the same, right? From a physics and geometry standpoint, this shouldn't be any more difficult than that one to hit. Now, if you got yourself all psyched up when you walk up to it, you know, and you're trying to do something with a club you can't, then that's another story, right? But if I had a robot right here, okay, and I set a robot up and I put a 60 degree wedge in his hand and hit five balls, and then a 56, then a 52, that robot's not gonna have any trouble. It's the same golf club, it's just got a face that's bent back more, okay? Does that make sense to everybody how I adjust the distance? Right now, I don't have the length of green to do this here, but I mean, I could go down to a pitching wedge and do the same thing. A pitching wedge is probably gonna land by that last golf cart, right? And it's not gonna roll very far. It's gonna stop just like the rest of them are. Might roll just a little more, right? The more loft you have, the more spin you'll get and it'll stop a little faster, right? But the system stays the same, okay? Lastly, well, first of all, does that make sense to everybody? Anybody got any questions on how I adjust the distance? Okay. Lastly, I'm gonna complicate it just a little bit and add a couple of little tricks, okay? Because I have the capability to kind of hit the tweeners, right? And by the tweeners, I mean if a 56 degree wedge is gonna go a little too far, but a 60 is not gonna quite go far enough, there are some adjustments I can make it set up that will allow me to hit those in between yardages, okay? And that's by moving the ball slightly in my stance, okay? If I keep my hands in the middle of my body and move the ball forward in my stance, what happens to the shaft lean? Leans backwards, which does what to loft? It increases. Conversely, if I move the ball backwards and keep the hands in the middle, Daly, to your point earlier, the shaft leans forward, right? And it takes loft off of it. Well, what will decreased loft do to ball flight? Lower. And what will that do to run out? Makes it run a little more, right? The spin won't quite grab as hard, okay? So I could make the exact same golf swing with this 56 degree wedge with the ball toward the back of my stance and now the shaft leaning forward. Right? Watch this ball when it hits. See it release just a little? Not gonna go far, maybe another 10 or 12 feet, but that may be enough to get me to that next distance, right? The other way to hit that golf shot, if I needed to take a little off of it, would be to move it more forward in my stance. And now for those of you, John and Terry, for you guys standing over there, now which way is the shaft leaning? It's almost backward, isn't it? Right? Chest, yeah, now the chest won't be as much in front, but I'm still forward like I was when I started, right? But because I'm returning the shaft slightly backward, I'm adding a lot of loft to the golf club. See how much higher and softer it comes out? Okay, that's an option. All right? So that's how you can get away with hitting those little in-between shots. If you need it to just jump a little bit, right? For example, I'm trying to think, number 10, right? That green is pitched from back to front, okay? If that pin's in the back, you might hit this shot with a little bit of forward shaft lean, right? So it can kind of land in the middle of the green and maybe take a little jump back there. Otherwise, it's gonna land and just stop because the slope of the green is going to act like a little backboard. Number four green might be, if the pin's on the front, might be another good example of that, right? Conversely, number 13, right? That really skinny little narrow green, right? That shot or that pin and that green is perfectly suited for the one that's going to go a little higher, right? Because that ball's going to stop sooner when it hits the green. It's not going to roll very far, okay? So that's a shot that you would not want to hit and take a big skid forward because it might go over the back of that green, you make double, right? So there's some ways you can manipulate setup a little bit to get some different things out of it, but I'm not moving differently. And that's the big take-home message, not only in this month, but last month and the month before that. I've done all this without really doing anything different other than making maybe a little bit bigger backswing and adding a piece, right? And that's really the take-home message to what I want you to learn when it comes to short game. It's really much simpler than most people give it credit for. Most people are scared to death of it and they want to complicate it, right? It's not a full swing, so that must mean that I've got to do something different. You do, but it's not that hard. It's just a matter of positioning your body right and having a little bit of tempo, right? Now, some of you guys out there are going to do some funky stuff at impact and throwing your hands at it. And I mean, there's some problems out there, right? See you guys. Thank you. And this setup's not going to change your life when it comes to that, right? If there are problems with impact, then we got to work those problems out, right? But I don't need you moving your body all over the place or sliding your knees or trying to scoop under it. It really is as simple as just sternum in front, shoulders, wrist, arms, and having some tempo, right? You don't need to complicate it any more than that. Does that make sense to everybody? Yeah? All right. So now I'm going to open the floor up to some questions because I've always got some great questions at the end of these. So what do you guys got? Fire away.
Brandon, what if, how do you position your body on a downhill lie on the same distance?
That's a great question. So you mean going, so my left foot's lower than my right foot? So what does that change to the low point of the arc or where the club's going to hit the ground? That's the question you have to answer, okay? All right, so if this is the ground, and ordinarily the club would hit the ground right at that shaft label, okay? And now the ground suddenly gets like this, where's the club going to hit? Behind it, okay? So what have I got to do to my sternum to accommodate that? I got to move it forward more. Now there are some negatives that come from that, right? The golf club will inherently deliver at a steeper angle, which has got more forward shaft lean. Ball's going to come out lower with less spin, right? So I might have to use a higher lofted wedge to try to overcompensate for some of that than I would use on a flat ground, if that makes sense. But that's the only change I would want you to make, right? No, I'd move it back in my stance. Yeah, because the club's going to, because the ground falls away, right, this way, the club hits the ground sooner. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, there's a lot of people and a lot of information out there that talks about, you know, get your weight left and match your shoulders up to the slope. Well, I don't disagree with that, but if the ground's falling away from you and you got more weight on your left leg, I promise you, your shoulders are going to match that slope. I hadn't seen somebody yet that stands on ground like this way, right? I mean, nobody does that, right? So your shoulders are going to do that naturally just as much as you'll ever need them to. The biggest thing you have to change is ball position because the club's going to hit the ground sooner. And it's the reverse of that if it's uphill, right? If it's uphill, the club hits the ground later in the arc, so you have to move it up in your stance a touch, and that adds loft. So you might have to go down in club selection to overcompensate for that, or to compensate for that. That makes sense? That answer your question? Okay, good question. Right? Don't be changing a whole lot of stuff. Don't get crazy on me when you're on slopes, right? Look, those are hard shots. I mean, I'm not gonna make light of them. I mean, they're tough. It's hard enough on flat ground, right? But please don't get nuts and start trying to, you know, lean your chest and shoulder. Just make a little adjustment. Do the best you can, right? If it's downhill, go a little higher loft, move the ball back, try to keep it on the green. That's about all you can hope for. That make sense? All right. What else you guys got?
Brandon, I want here for the previous thing.
Yep.
When you was doing the tipping.
Yep.
But what did you tell everybody?
In my opinion, nothing changes, right? In my opinion, adjustments made to try to overcome the lie usually end up causing more problems than they don't, right? Now, the thinner the lie gets, the better your technique has to be to hit the shot. But a lot of people will talk about, you know, if it's a bare lie or a really tight lie, I want to move the ball back and lean the shaft forward. Well, let me tell you what happens when you do that, right? As the shaft leans forward, I don't know if you can see this or not, Howard, but as the shaft leans forward, what happens to that leading edge? You see it turn into a little shovel? Well, how much more precise do you have to be with a shovel than you would if you had the entire soul down there helping you? Right? So I think a lot of people hurt themselves by trying to make an adjustment that they've, you know, read in a magazine or heard somebody say before that, quite frankly, is bad information in my opinion, right? I mean, it might help you catch it a little cleaner, but that's assuming you have the skill to catch it cleaner and use the shovel, right? And if you can do that, then great. But most people can't, right? So I would rather just see you use the golf club appropriately. I don't think there really are any changes. Now, if you have a heavy, thick lie, okay, you're going to have a lot of grass that gets between the face of the club and the ball as you strike it, right? So one of the benefits I have off this fairway lie is that I can catch the golf ball cleanly. In other words, the club face hits the ball before it hits the ground, okay? When you're in deep, heavy grass, such as the rough we have here, you get all that grass between the face and the ball, and your clean contact goes away. Okay, now that does two things. The first thing it does is it hurts the speed. Okay, so the ball doesn't come off the face as fast, and therefore you have to hit it harder to get out of that lie than you would if it were on fairway lie. That's the first thing. And the second thing is any spin you get out of it, right? You've watched me hit these shots where they land and take a hop and stop. That won't happen out of the rough, right? Because there's too much crap between the face of the club and the ball for the club to grab a hold of it and have that friction. So you have to allow for it to roll a little more when you're coming out of that lie. Does that make sense? Right? I don't have any rough around here I'd show you, but no, ma'am. No, ma'am. Now, well, I should go back. Ordinarily, no. Now, if you're a week after the state am and the rough is this deep out here, then maybe you have to make it a little steeper to get down at it. That would be moving the ball a little more back in your stance, right? Now, remember, that has a negative or a decreasing effect on loft, so you might have to add some loft to compensate for the steep angle of attack. But I would tell you that ordinarily around here, when they keep the rough at the normal height, at least in the 7 months I've been here, you don't really have to make any changes coming out of the rough. You just have to hit it harder, right? Because the club can get hung in that rough, or, you know, it can go right under it, you know, sometimes, and you just have to give it more juice, right? That makes sense? Okay. What else you guys got? Oh, come on. You can't be done with questions already.
How do you stop just an involuntary fire of your right hand when you get to the top?
Practice. Right?
Alcohol.
Terry, his question, Terry, was how do you stop an involuntary fire of the right hand as you strike the golf ball, right? So that's a big problem for a lot of people, right? So here's the thing about golf, right? We have this heavy piece of metal at the end of a 35-inch stick, okay? Now, at the end of the day, this club head weighs about a pound, 402 grams, give or take, right? At the end of a 35-inch stick, it feels a lot heavier than a pound. And now if you put it in motion, it feels a lot heavier than a pound. And there's this myth that if you take your hands and you try and speed the golf club up at the bottom, you can make it go faster. That's one reason people do that. And by that, I mean, again, just take their right hand and kind of throw the head of the club at it. The other reason Duncan people do it a lot is they're trying to get under it and add loft. right? So they think if they throw the head, they'll scoop right under it and they'll add some loft and get some height, okay? You really have to work hard to try to return the shaft to the same position you set it up in, right? So if you set it up straight up and down, you got all this movement, you really want to try to return it straight up and down. So here's the thought I'd want you to have. I'd want you to think about the left arm and the left, or in the club, being a door, okay? Now, normal doors don't have a hinge in the middle, but our door's a little different, right? It's got a hinge in the middle. I want you to think about the right arm and the shoulder opening that door, right? And then you're going to take the left shoulder and the right arm and close the door when you hit. That makes sense, right? So from down here, the right shoulder and right arm open the door, and the left shoulder pulls and the right arm pushes to close the door, right? And that puts more of the thought on the handle and less of the thought on the head, right? Now, you know as well as I do, you're not going to go out tomorrow and use that tip and get rid of that, right? It's going to take some effort and some drills and some things to do, but that's a thought to put in your head of how to get rid of that. So instead of thinking about moving the head of the golf club, right, you think about moving the handle by turning and pushing in the downswing, if that makes sense. So you turn it away and push it down, right? And that helps you to deliver the golf club more in line with your left arm as opposed to doing this. Does that make sense? Okay. The other thing I'll say to that is you have to keep your body moving, right? You have to keep moving through the shot, because if your body stops and you've got a pound of weight moving at 40 miles an hour, it's going to go on, right? So you got to keep all the circle moving. Remember, the golf swing's a circle beginning at the left shoulder, right? And if any part of that circle stops, the rest of it's going to keep going, right? So you got to keep the whole circle moving if you want to keep that from happening. That's a tough problem, right? A lot of people have that. A lot of people have that. So that's a little thought process to help you next time you're out there. All right, what else you got? Well, I would just need to move closer to the green, right? Or, I mean, I could, now, please understand, I would never hit this shot on a golf course, but I could just use more club and show you the shot, right? So I'm just going to use a 9-iron. Now, this thing's going to roll way too far, right? But a hinge and hole is just a smaller version, right? So in this golf, in the pitch swing, I had shoulders, I had some wrist hinge, and I had some arm swing. Well, the hinge and hole just takes away the arm swing. Okay, so the club goes from about parallel to about parallel to the ground, right? Looks something like this. Now that ball's going to go way too far, right? I would never hit that shot here, but for the sake of running up there and trying to hit it, that's the hinge and hold, right? So if I do that with a 56 degree sand wedge, I get a shot that flies, you know, approximately 15 yards. Which is a good shot, it's just not enough on this particular hole.
What is the hold?
The hold is just hold the angle in the finish, right? So there's no recoil. There's none needed either, because I don't have enough momentum to take me up here. Think about it being the same length on either side, right? So if you're gonna go back and you're gonna get the golf club to go up here, it probably needs to return up here. If you're gonna go back and it's gonna be about parallel with the ground, it needs to return parallel. Or if it's a chip shot and it stops about right there, it's going to stop about right there. So that's the hold, right? Okay, what else you guys got? Pitching 101.
Up slope and down slope. How would you stand above the ball?
You mean if the ball's up here? So I'm standing like this. Is that what you mean? So the ball, I'm standing this way. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Nothing changes. Absolutely nothing changes. It's a harder shot because it's not level ground, but nothing changes. Thanks, guys. Okay.